Now we're live. All right, you can say hey now.
Yes. Here with introduce yourself.
I'm Wayne Philmore, evangelical Christian, former science teacher, Christian apologist, and what more can I say? I debated Kent Hovind last year. Really good friends with Dr. Hugh Ross and Fazel Rana, and working on the long road and path to obtaining my PhD in theoretical astrophysics. So. What more can I say?
Well, you've just shown me up. I'm a guy with a YouTube channel, and I'm on the road to cleaning my apartment. So that's I've got nothing.
But I'm here with Deflating Atheism, and Deflating Atheism, you actually introduce yourself.
There's not a whole lot to say. I'm a guy with an opinion and a YouTube channel, which is worth so much in this day and age.
So, hey, you're a guy with the right opinion, though. So
thank you. But yeah, so I'm a guy with an opinion. Yes, that's
pretty much, nonetheless. But we actually decided. I got in touch with Deflating Atheism about a week ago. And I saw one of your videos, and I was like, oh, this guy is awesome. He's a really good apologist. And so I said, let me just hit him up, because that's what people do. You know, people always say it's so hard to get in touch with people, but nowadays we live in a society where, like, if they're on Facebook or they have, like, an Instagram or social media, there is no excuse. You can just inbox somebody, hey, I want to do a video with you. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah. It just has to do with how much attitude they have. It's like, yeah, how standoffish they're going to be, you know.
Speaking of attitude, I'll get to that in a minute, but long story short, our topic for the day is the limits of scientism, which scientism basically is the belief that everything can be proven scientifically through the scientific method, which, of course, we know that to be false, but for our atheist buddies, boys and girls, they need some education on that, and I'm the perfect person to actually talk about this, being that I'm a former science teacher. And Deflating Atheism, let's just start off with your opinion on it, because you're going to YouTube.
First off, I don't think that definition you just gave, it is part of it. It is not the whole of it. And I think scientism takes on more. It's only scientific questions are worth pursuing. Only questions with scientific answers should be worthy of our interest, which I think is the kind of broader reading of scientism, you know. Now, what you said, that is definitely a part of scientism, although I don't think it's the whole of it.
Okay.
And I also think it ties into a kind of a narrative of history where science is kind of perceived as the savior of history, you know.
Which isn't true, but... So speaking of which, I just want to start off, because this is just some things I was thinking about earlier. Because I've noticed that in this day and age where we live in a society where most of the college students I'm around, they hold to this view of scientism as well. And they also think that some of the most prominent scientists were atheists. They think some of the most prominent scientists of our time actually held to this belief of scientism. But believe it or not, the prevailing scientists who actually, we basically built the measures in the props and everything from the science from the past, they were actually theists, and not just any theist, Christian theists.
Yes.
The father of Big Bang cosmology was a Catholic priest.
Yes. And I think it should also be pointed out that these were not merely scientists who happened to be Christians. They often perceived it to be two sides of the same coin. It's not like, you know, you're a scientist who does stamp collecting on the side. It's completely unrelated. They felt that the book of science and the book of revealed truth of religious wisdom were one and the same. That examining nature was a way of worshiping God. You know,
I like that. Yeah, it's called the two books of Revelation. God has given us the 66 books of the Bible, and He's also given us the 67th being reality. Which atheists deny every day, but okay. just a slight jab at my atheist buddies. But with that being said, there was a debate I had saw, I think about last week, with John Lennox and Peter Atkins. So both of those guys are professors. John Lennox, he's a professor in mathematics. John Lennox, he's an atheist, and he's a professor in, I think, biology, if I'm correct. And you John Lennox.
Okay.
What you say?
Oh, I'm sorry. John Lennox is the mathematician. Peter Atkins is the atheist.
Yep. I'm sorry. And Peter Atkins, he has said something that kind of scared me. He has said that if we can't scientifically prove it, we can't believe it. And John Lennox scratches his head and he's like, you can't scientifically prove the words that just came out of your mouth.
Yeah. I mean that it ends right. It is the most easily falsifiable assertion. It does not pass critical scrutiny at the most basic level, you know.
And I'm just sitting here like, I can't believe there are boys and girls who look up to you, Peter Atkins, because and when you talk to people like this, they can't see the flaws in that particular view. So when you try and point out that when you try and point out their scientism to them, they think their scientism is science.
Yes.
But it's not.
Yes. Yes.
You ever had an experience like this where you try and say, no, your scientism and actual science are not one of the same coin. You have a religious view. And they're like, no, this isn't like a religious philosophical view. This is science. Science proves all things. And then they start deifying science. It's scary.
Well, they use the language in a very loosey-goosey way, and so they will often use scientism, their own kind of unacknowledged belief of scientism, with the same word that they used to refer to science, and by the same token, they also use science to refer just to the natural world. You know, there's an author, Sam Chris. He talks about how atheists will have little meme graphics that shows the constellations or, you know, it shows nebulae or something in the sky, and they'll talk about science. No, that's not science. That's the natural world. Mm-hmm. And so they use it interchangeably with the natural world, and they use the word science interchangeably with their own scientism.
Yeah, it's pretty weird.
And so it's very hard to know at any one time what they're talking about. So you really need to nail them down on it, you know?
Yes, yes. And so I guess one of the things you could say is, you know, when you say science can, you know, or everything in the universe needs to be scientifically proven, I guess, like, could you give an example of just one field? Like for example, can science tell us anything about right or wrong? I mean, that right there, it nails into the coffin. Because that's not what science is for. So if you're going to a scientist and asking them about whether abortion is moral or not, we can't test that. We can't, like, put a baby in a lab and then we say, oh, yeah, well, the test confirmed that it is evil if you go through with this abortion or if you don't. So it's
I'm certain they would say that science can tell us right or wrong. In fact, there's a video of Bill Nye essentially saying that, you know. But that's just more bad philosophy on their part. In truth, science cannot tell us about right or wrong, but like Sam Harris, he simply redefines creaturely well-being. He has this kind of hedonic calculus of what he calls creaturely well-being, and he redefines that as morality and solves the problem. Well, you can't solve a problem simply by redefining something as morality. Otherwise, why do we have two separate terms, you know?
Right. What I tend to notice with these type of people is they go and they talk about biological evolution, like you said, they redefine terms, and then they start talking about philosophical evolution. So humans evolved up into this point where morality evolved with us, and we became so moral and obsolete to our other creatures that came before us. And I'm like, whoa. This isn't evolution. This is like some pseudoscience, almost in a sense, younger creationist stuff.
Yeah.
We evolved to a point where we we became more moral than our other ancestors. And I'm just like, okay, but why? Because scientifically, we can't actually show any of this. We can't prove any of this. This is like speculation. I can show you how we got here, but you know why we got here and stuff like that, and the questions behind it. Those aren't scientific questions. So when people say, you know, God's existence or, you know, why is the universe here? Those aren't questions that you can put into the scientific realm. And I honestly, I would say that science doesn't have a place in those questions. And the philosophy and the theology, they don't necessarily have a place in the science. I mean, you can intertwine them together, but they're not mutually connected to one another. So.
Yeah. Going back to what you were saying about morality, that's another thing where they will use evolutionary psychology, which for the most part, there's no real science in evolutionary psychology. What it does is it gives you naturalistic answers. And I think a lot of atheists make the mistake of assuming that a naturalistic answer is a scientific answer. Mm. And that goes back to equivocating science with naturalism, which is not the case. You know, you can have a naturalistic explanation for something, but it is not necessarily a scientific explanation.
Yeah, I see. So what I tend to notice is, you know, sure, atheists like to demythologize supernatural worldviews and et cetera. And then as a result of them having to demythologize the supernatural, yeah, you're only left with the natural. But at the same time, like any explanation is not a scientific one. So if you just cross out God and you say, okay, God's out the picture, and now we have these 99 other natural possibilities, you still have to do the hard work of, what's the word I'm looking for? You have to do the hard work of, it's a type of reasoning, not induction, not deduction. It is, you still have to do the hard work. There you go, abduction, of crossing out the other possibilities and coming to the right conclusion. But yeah. What I see from atheists is they're just throwing out anything. Maybe we got here through aliens. Maybe we got here because
maybe there's a multiverse. I'm like, maybe. I thought you liked proof. I thought you liked proof and evidence. Why are you telling me maybe? You know?
Don't even get me started on the multiverse.
Okay. Like I said, there were a lot of directions I wanted to go into. But yeah. And also, it also makes me kind of angry when they say, oh, well, Christians just kind of put God outside of space and time because that's where science can't disprove him. No, that's an essential part of the definition of God, is that he had to be outside of space and time to bring space and time into being. He can't bring space and time into being if he's inside space and time, because that would be causally prior to itself, which was incoherent. But yeah, so they have this bad historical view, this bad philosophical view of God, and it all just ties into this kind of horrid ideology of scientism.
Yeah, it's really strange. So me, what I do, even when I'm looking at the Bible, I don't look at the Bible as a science book. And even me, I'm a former science teacher, but what I would pressure a lot of Westerns to do, a lot of Western atheists, even a lot of Western Christians, when you come to the book, when you come to any ancient text, like the Bible or the Book of Enoch or the Book of Jasher or whatever you think about modern science, you have to not throw out the window per se, but put it on the table and put it aside and let the ancient text say what the ancient text says.
Yes.
And let it speak for itself.
Yes. Yes.
Because you had people come into the Bible, and you know, I think somebody asked me, they said, how come the Bible doesn't mention string theory? And I'm like,
but you know, the funny thing is for the 2000 years before we figured out string theory, the atheists would just be saying, oh, the Bible is just a bunch of nonsense. It says all this stuff about strings that's unproven, you know. It's like they give you this complete red herring. And it's like even if it met their standards, they would still find a reason to deny it. You know.
Yes, yes, and that's my point. So like what I like to say to a lot of atheists is, do you understand the Bible isn't a science textbook? Because obviously they don't know, because they're like, how come like this book doesn't talk about genetic drift and evolution? And I'm like, do you not understand who wrote the book? Do you like? I don't think Moses had in mind about evolutionary biology when he was writing down the book of Genesis. I mean, you can tell from the text. I mean, they thought water came from this glass dome. They had a different cosmology of the world than you and I. So,
like, yeah.
Scientism doesn't work when you come to ancient texts either. It actually destroys the ancient texts. And I'll give you a really good example of this. People who use this frame of reference when they're looking at the text are younger creationists. They're looking to the text and they try and read their science into an ancient book. Atheists try to read their science into an ancient book. And then they're like, oh, this book doesn't make any sense. And I'm like, you don't make any sense. You're trying to bring your modern scientific beliefs into this ancient book. It's an ancient text. These people didn't know anything about evolution or cosmology or astrophysics. They didn't have a word for astrophysics.
Yeah.
So it's pretty laughable when even you try and bring science into there. I mean, yeah, science is a tool for finding out how the natural world operates, but it's one of many tools. We also have mathematics. We also have history. We also have English, of course, psychology, and we have so many different tools, and we need to put them together so we can get a bigger picture. So me as a science teacher, I would say I love science. Science is awesome. Science is a gift that God has given us, but it doesn't show, like you said earlier about what I said about scientism, it doesn't show the big picture about the world.
Yeah. Also the thing that as our understanding of the world has expanded, so has our concern, so has our conception. And I don't need to get into this with you, but the whole thing where atheists say, oh, well, the Bible says the earth is flat because it uses the word circle. And they also say it's flat because it talks about the four corners of the earth. So there are two arguments why the Bible says the earth is flat. Actually contradict each other, but we're not going to get into that. It is both square and a circle. But it goes back into the Hebrew word. That basically means circle around. They did not have a dedicated word for sphere, but then they're only really describing the border of Judea, you know, because the ancients weren't really overly concerned with this idea of the whole world.
Right. They only knew about the little Near Eastern world they were at.
Yes. Now they could expand their thought, but that was not in their concern, was this idea of the whole world. And so it's not really clear if the Bible ever really talks about the whole world, you know?
Right, as we know it today, when we think about the whole world, we think about North America, South America, Australia, yeah. Europe, etc. But yeah, to them, in their minds, like even when I hear people argue about the flood, for example, so my view, of course, is I think the flood was local. There are other Christians. I have to emphasize they are Christians, and they believe there was a worldwide flood. And there's Christians on both sides of it. There's Christians who think it was a local one, Christians who think it wasn't. And the younger creationists say that people who believe in a local flood are going to hell. But I have no say in that.
You're lying.
I have no dogma. But
it floods the land, which is still the same sense of the word we use in this day and age.
Yes. And so, yes, I see your point. And also, I would like to point out, speaking about sciences and different cosmologies and et cetera, number one, if it weren't for the failed cosmologies back in those times, like ancient Near Eastern cosmology, and then we kept on going up until, we have the astronomers like Aristotle and et cetera, we wouldn't have modern Big Bang cosmology like we have today, because we had to revise those old cosmologies and build off of those. And so when Neil deGrasse Tyson, who's an atheist, he says something like, everybody back then were stupid and the people who wrote down the Bible were dumb. Well, if it weren't for their failed science experiments and their failed information, we wouldn't have anything to build off of. So you wouldn't have the modern science you now have today. We should be thanking our lucky stars that these people actually had the goals to go out and fail.
Yeah.
So
what you said, kind of one of the more interesting concepts, just kind of under the kind of broad rubric of intelligent design, is that the universe is designed for discoverability. Which means that we have these stair steps, and the first stair step is just classical Newtonian physics. The second stair step is relativity. The third stair step is quantum physics, and who knows, there might be you know, string theory or something beyond that. But we cannot get to any one of those stair steps without the step below it. There's no way we could have gone directly to quantum physics without these intermediate relativity and classical mechanics, you know. So there's this whole thing that the universe is not only intelligently designed in how it operates, but it is intelligently designed to be discoverable.
I like that. There's a saying my friend, he has, he's a physicist in aerodynamics, and he's a Christian. And one of the sayings we basically keep on saying to each other, as a matter of fact, is if you read Psalms 19 in the Bible, it talks about how the heavens declare the glory of God, and that the universe is, in a sense, sentient. The universe is intelligible. The yes. universe can speak, but the universe doesn't use words to speak. And people are like, what are you talking about? Well, when we do science, we're not getting our information from nowhere. We're not getting our information from nothing. We're getting our information from something. Where, so when we do, when I write a physics equation, like for example, E equals MC squared, everybody knows that. We're getting these physics equations from our observations that we make in reality. So we look at something in reality, we observe it, and then we write down how it operates. And the funny thing is, our science can't work. We can't get these physics equations unless the universe works in a way that communicates with us. And if the universe doesn't communicate in the way we actually can write down these equations, science can't work. So our science is only even possible from if the natural world operates in an orderly, intelligent way. And for people to say that the universe came from blind, mindless chance, but we're getting the same information from the universe that's orderly and complex and sophisticated, it doesn't really make any sense for them to make the argument, because science can only work if the theist position is correct. The universe is intelligible. That's how we do math. As a matter of fact, there was a guy who did an experiment a couple months ago, and he found out that when he looked into the fabric of space, he saw what he thought were numbers, but they were actually just numerical patterns that were familiar to us only because we know what numbers are. So long story short, there are mathematical patterns inside of the fabric of space, almost as if we're in a computer simulation. How sophisticated is that? Yes. I think atheism died right there.
Yes. I think I remember something about that. Something with a form like a triangular numbers or something.
Yes,
I can't remember what it was, but yeah, it was very odd and like way above my head. So I stopped reading about halfway through the article, but yes.
You got it. And a point in case is, what I like to do is I like to rewind the clock. And so in the same sense, we're using computers now. We're using computers that are basically wirelessly hooked up to satellites up in space, and they're using triangulation to send the signals back and forth. But the only reason this is possible is because intelligent people put this laptop together, and we can do this thing. We can talk. I'm talking to the screen right now. But the funny thing is, if you rewind the clock in the same sense how we made a computer simulation, and we're also living in a computer simulation just for the sheer fact that we can recreate what we are in by us creating computers, we're actually recreating how the simulation was done in the first place. And so who made the simulation? Intelligent people. And we're also in a simulation. So what does that tell you? Maybe an intelligent person made the simulation we're in. I'm just saying.
Yeah, I don't like the whole simulation hypothesis, because the point about a simulation is that it's not the real thing. Mm. It can give you the output that the real thing gives you, but it is not the real thing. I can simulate the growth of a plant in my computer. I can do a mathematical model of a violin string vibrating, but it's not the same thing. All I'd have is the mathematical simulation. It could tell me where the string is at a point in space, but it won't actually be the sound. And just like a simulation of consciousness, it could give you the output. You could put in inputs and get in outputs just like you could with a conscious sentient being, but it is not itself consciousness. So that's kind of my objection.
Well, I will say this: no matter what we find out in science, Christians, theists, we really don't have anything to like be afraid of, because Yeah. It all, like, this is God's universe anyway, so God could have made it any way he wanted to. The question is, what did he do? And also, not only what did he do, the things that we don't necessarily know about, you know, we do take those, I guess you could say, by faith. But it's not a blind faith. It's a faith off of the evidence that we do have from the natural world. And so the science gives us more reasons to believe in the things we can't necessarily prove at this point. I'm not saying, you know, we'll never be able to prove them, but scientifically, we do have limits.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's what I would say. But also, speaking about our limits, last summer, there was an experiment where scientists in India were trying to resurrect people from the dead. So that's kind of ironic. So if scientists ever do that, Christians,
what could possibly go wrong? Yes.
Yeah. You're right. If they ever do that, Christians can look into our atheist buddy's face and we can say, I told you so. Oh, we're almost, let me see, about 4 or 5 more minutes. Because I do want to keep this on time. But I guess since you're the guest, any more? Because you did bring up some good topics today. What other topics could we bring up before we go?
Well, no, I had this guy. By the way, well, I was kind of going through your channel. I was trying to figure out what time zone you're in, because are you Central Time Zone?
Eastern Standard.
Okay. Because I was trying to find out where you were, and so I accidentally clicked on some of your comments on your YouTube channel. And I'm sorry. I mean, I thought the comments I was getting was bad. Were bad. You know, it's just the same crap. But I have a comment. I kind of pulled it up here, and it's this guy who commented on my channel, and he says, yes, and so he says, the claimed existence of God does contradict all scientific models. God is said to be supernatural. Nothing in science deals with the supernatural. And so that he uses that to claim that the existence of God contradicts all scientific models. It is such a bad logic. It's almost, how could you argue with something like that? You just have to state, you can't even engage these people on their own terms. You just have to say your entire premises are wrong. You have no idea how to construct an argument, you know?
And they don't know how science works.
And he says, since no scientific model uses the supernatural, then yes, it does contradict. And I said, well, you know, a Betty Crocker cake recipe doesn't use the Pythagorean theorem. We do not say that a Betty Crocker cake recipe contradicts the Pythagorean theorem. That's not the kind of logic we would use in any other case.
How come when it comes to these logical fallacies, you can only apply these logical fallacies that would never work anywhere else in real life, but if you apply them to God, oh my gosh, you are like a powerhouse atheist. Like,
like internet atheism is like an omnibus of just like bad arguments. It is astounding, and I think they've lured themselves into this by constantly reassuring themselves that they are the intellectual high ground. They've just stopped trying. If you can convince yourself you're already the rational superiors, you there's no vigilance upon yourself to actually make sure that what you're saying isn't horseshit, you know.
And speaking of that, I made a post. You might have seen it on my page about rationality, about being a reasonable faith or being a rational religion. Just because you have a rational belief, that does not make it true. You still have work to do. You still have to prove your position.
Yeah.
Oh gosh, these people are just laughable.
With so many atheists, it doesn't even rise to that level when they say, "Oh, well, someday science will explain how the universe came to be." No, we don't need to wait for the results to come in. You know, it's like saying, "Oh, well, someday we'll discover if a bachelor can be married. We just don't have all the information." No, we can say that a bachelor is by definition unmarried, you know, and we can say that science we will never get a scientific account of the origin of the universe, since the science would have to explain how those scientific laws themselves came into being.
Which science can't do, but yeah. I mean, it seems like, so Neil deGrasse Tyson, he says something in a video. He says, when certain religious people go after science and they say stuff like, we don't know how things work, therefore God, like for example, we don't know how the tides work, we don't know how gravity works, or et cetera, therefore it must be God. And then he says, but we do know how these things work. And so what you're doing actually is, he basically says, you're putting God in a box. And every time we find out something new about the natural world, it makes your God recede back into, I think he calls it like an ignorant pocket or whatever. And so my thing is, in the same sense he's arguing against somebody for the God of the gaps, atheists do the same exact thing.
Yes.
With naturalism of the gaps. For every answer they don't have, well, science will find out one day. But
yeah.
these things aren't scientific questions. Like, the existence of God is not a scientific question. You can't scientifically put God in a test tube and bring him into a lab.
Yes, yes. Well, that goes back to scientism, and which there's a little catchphrase that some other Christians have come up with to parody the atheist position, which is either put God under a microscope or he doesn't exist. It's like, yeah, well, the God that could be put under a microscope is not the God we believe in. So, you know.
Put God under a microscope. Wow. I mean, I thought my imagination was bad, but their imagination is terrible.
Well, no, this is not what atheists say. This is the kind of what Christians characterize the atheist argument as. But
It is like that. And it's terrible. A God who, like, we can actually bring into a lab and dissect and, like, do biochemistry on, I will laugh at that God.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it goes back into the whole kind of the word is escaping me at this point, but the whole basic straw man of the invisible man in the sky. That is what atheists have determined that they are going to try to disprove, because they can't even wrap their minds around the transcendent first cause that God is. They're only interested in the invisible man in the sky.
And then you try and say, no, I don't believe that God is some invisible guy with a gray beard in the sky. And they say, no, you do, because he does magic. And I'm like, what?
And that's another thing is, I've actually addressed this in one of my videos. It's like, when you talk about, I know that, like, they say these things because they think that they're trivializing and they're belittling religious belief. But all it does is underline their own complete philosophical illiteracy. So, I mean, if you're going to call something magic, that would presuppose that there's a set of natural laws in place that this magic acts as a foil to. But when we're talking about God, who put those laws into action in the first place, to talk about magic is completely meaningless, because there are no physical laws for the magic to contravene. So, I mean, it's completely incoherent, you know?
Pretty much. Speaking about magic and miracles and et cetera, so when I looked through the Gospels and I put them to the test, because there were, so the first time as a Christian, I opened up the Bible and I read it, and I thought it was pretty awesome. About the second and third time, with my new scientific knowledge that I got, I said, you know what, let me see if I can actually put, you know, these miracles to the test. Me as a theistic evolutionist, order of creationist, whatever you want to call it, when I look at a miracle, I don't see it as a bad thing. I don't see God doing tricks. I see God using natural laws that he set in place in a way that those humans in those ancient times didn't necessarily understand yet. But as our science gets better and our understanding of the natural world expands, we can actually start to understand at least a little bit how some of the miracles in the Gospels were done. I'll give you a really good example. There's a story about Jesus and his disciples going across this river. And as they're halfway across the river, one minute they're in the sea, right? They're like in the middle of the, I'm sorry, I said a river. They're in the sea. And then the next second, they're on land. And so I'm trying to think, what happened here? And so we know on a quantum level, molecules are moving all the time. They're moving from one place to another, or atoms. Atoms are moving from one place to another. They're doing what's called a quantum leap. And so when you think about that exact story in the Gospels, you could say scientifically, it seems like Jesus did a quantum leap across the sea. How could these ancient people have known about this stuff like that? Now, we know today we could apply it.
It's not necessary. I mean,
right, you could, even though you could apply it to the Gospels, you could say, you know, how could these people have known about this stuff? And honestly, they didn't. They didn't know about this stuff. Maybe they just wrote about something that happened, because obviously they didn't have the knowledge to expand on what they experienced. So all they said is, I don't know what happened. It was a miracle.
Yeah.
To them. You know, and so when I look at the science and et cetera and the miracles, I think the miracles of the Bible prove Jesus, his existence and his divinity that much more. I think it's a beautiful thing. I don't see it as a hassle.
Yeah, that's what I think a lot of people miss about miracles. They're not just random abrogations of natural laws just for shits and giggles. There's always some demonstrative value, and it's typically to demonstrate, Jesus's divinity, or to demonstrate that God is causes the universe, that he who put these laws into being in the first place can, you know, suspend them at will, and so it's not just, they're not just random flaws in the kind of nexus of physical laws. They have some demonstrative value. So even though the laws of physics themselves are intelligible, these suspensions of the laws of physics too are intelligible in their own way. They're not random. They have demonstrative value in proving Jesus's divinity or whatnot.
Right. So,
intelligible in both directions.
So
either
way we win. So either way we win. But
whereas atheists just have these laws that just are in place for no particular reason whatsoever, and there's no reason to believe that they'll continue being the case. That's rational. Yes.
No reason, no purpose, no meaning. But yeah, it's okay. And then I've heard some atheists, they refer to, they keep on referring back to the universe, or they'll say like they'll say stuff like natural selection thought it to be best, or the universe thought it to be best. And I'm sitting here thinking, natural selection does not think. It's a process. The universe does not think. Like, what are you talking about? And so they kind of like relate. They kind of go into like pantheism or like some type of deism. It's really strange.
Anthropomorphic fallacy. This is what I also noticed. I talk with Max a bit about this, and it's different than what you're saying, but it's also kind of similar. When atheists say, religion pretends it has all the answers, science is always willing to admit it's wrong. How can an abstract noun admit something? How can an abstract noun? No, that's people. People admit when they're wrong. People believe they're right. You know, it's why are you attributing the actions of people to these abstract nouns of capital S science and capital R religion? You know.
Yeah, that's scary.
Yeah,
that's scary.
And it's a very inexact language, and I really think we as Christians need to nail them down on that kind of language as quickly as possible. And yeah, that's what a lot of my interactions are these days. you don't even get out of the gate, you know.
Well, speaking of which, since I just started up college again. Unfortunately, when you want to obtain a PhD, you'll be in college for a long time. But even in my class, there's some people I guess you could say I tangle with, and it's kind of interesting to me how there are people who have a good college level understanding of how natural processes work and how science does this and that, and when it comes to theology, it seems like everything they know about science goes out the window. And I'm like, you know what this this formula means, and you know what this, you know, mathematical algorithm is, and et cetera. But like I said, when it comes to God, it's like all this stuff goes out the window. And like, I'll give you one. The universe having a beginning. So for me, I think Big Bang cosmology falsified atheism. I don't know about anybody else, but when we found out the universe had a beginning, that was it. And so I'll be talking with some people, and they'll say, no. Just because the universe has a beginning, that doesn't mean God. It just means we don't know. And I'm like, but we do know. We know that if the universe had a beginning, there was a beginning. And they're like, no, just give us time. And then they'll say stuff like,
the implication was apparently clear enough for the USSR, who actively suppressed knowledge of the Big Bang theory because they thought it made too great a concession to the idea of biblical creation. Obviously, they saw it as a threat. Now, this goes back to the kind of Neil deGrasse Tyson, and I don't think he's the most toxic guy. He's one of those guys like Penn Jillette. He'll say one thing that's like really offensively stupid, and they'll say another thing is like, oh, well, maybe he's on the right track. Do you know, it almost seems like, you know, he's doing like a little dance or something where he says something to kind of provoke you, but they'll say this, oh, well, maybe he's, you know, he's not so far off track. But what was I going to say?
Basically you're saying that Neil deGrasse Tyson, he says something. You're saying he says something.
Yeah. Oh, geez. I forgot.
You talk about Big Bang cosmology, then you ask. Yes.
Well, no, it goes back to the view that we're learning more about the universe, and God is just being continually painted into us ever, ever smaller corner. I thought you were going to climb out the window to get out of this Google Hangout. But yes, no, that's not the case. Because over the past century, the scientific case for God has gotten much stronger.
Way stronger.
Because a century ago, people basically believed in the steady state universe that had always existed. People had no idea about the astounding fine tuning of the universe, of our galaxy, of life. People, yeah, we know about things like genetic inheritance. We had no idea that DNA is like a computer. No, it's not. Those little gods not being built, the gaps are actually demanding. They're ever more than ever before, they're crying out for a designer. I mean, the case for God has only gotten stronger. And so this whole new atheism, this whole kind of their whole narrative of God of the gaps seems really retrograde and very antiquated at this point. They seem completely 19th century in their thinking, you know?
It's funny because that's not what the actual science is saying, but it seems like the only reason why people believe it is because, yes, today, majority of the atheists we see on TV, like the speakers and stuff like that, yes, they are atheists. But when you get into like a field like astronomy, most astronomers are theists. They might not be Christians, but they're deists. And you know, the biologists and et cetera that we see, most of them are Christian as well. Catholic, still Christian. But the scientists we see represented by the scientific community most of the times happen to be atheists. Therefore, we think science is intrinsically atheistic, but we don't know about the scientists in the past, and we don't know about the majority of, like, for example, the leader of the Human Genome Project, Francis Collins, evangelical Christian. Hugh Ross, he's an astronomer, evangelical Christian. Faisal Rana, who's best friends with Hugh Ross, he actually just sent me his book, biochemist. So I mean, atheism doesn't have a restriction to scientific findings. And if you ask me, atheism and science don't have anything to do with one another. So I don't know why people keep on equating being atheist with being a scientist.
Yeah, well, there's very bad formulations, like I read to you for my comments. Very bad arguments like that. Now, of course, you could go back and you know, say, you know, of course, Newton and Kepler and even Galileo. I mean, atheists like to paint him as a martyr for their cause. He was a devout, you know, Christian as much as anyone. But I was like, oh, well, that was centuries ago. We've learned so much more nowadays. Okay, so what have we learned that this proves the existence of God? So, no, I don't have to answer that. I don't have to prove a negative. So it's a complete feint, but yes. But yeah, there is a study they go back to, the whole 1998. It was an informal survey of the National Academy of Sciences. I feel like I'm talking over you a lot at this point. I apologize.
No, you're fine. You're fine.
But yeah, so they'll go back to this 1998 survey. Where I'm sure you've heard it's like 93% of the National Academy of Sciences, God bless you, said that they were irreligious or something. You cannot find the primary source of this. It was an informal survey. It was in 1998. You cannot find – it's just – at this point, it's almost like an urban legend. But yes. But it's so easy to knock something like that out. Okay, well, let's look at Nobel Prize winners in physics. That seemed like a fairly sturdy standard for establishing a religion in science. You'll find that a greater percentage of winners of the Nobel Prize in physics are Christian than there is among the general population. So there goes your whole narrative, you know?
Bam, right out the window. And speaking about fine-tuning too, right before we get up out of here. So we've learned very little about dark energy. Speaking of science, I think we know about like what, 30% about the universe, and the rest is all dark stuff that we just don't understand. It's dark matter and dark energy.
Yeah.
And what we do know about dark energy is this. So last year, with the gravity waves we made, with the gravitational instruments that we use so we could detect gravity waves, dark energy actually exceeds the best human design, which was gravity waves, gravity telescopes, by 10 to the 97 times. That is how much more fine-tuned dark energy is than that of the best human design of the 21st century. 10 to the 97 times much more sophisticatedly fine-tuned in design than gravity waves.
Okay. So we have our instruments. That's hard for me to understand.
we have our instruments and our stuff that can detect the most slightest wave of gravity in the universe, in the fabric of space time, and our instruments don't even come anywhere close to dark energy. And dark energy is a natural phenomena. That humans didn't create. It's been here for billions of years. And it's more like, how? I can't wrap my head around that. And so,
well, the cosmological constant, I think, is fine-tuned to a degree of 10 to the 120th power, which is unimaginably more than there are particles in the universe.
And when atheists say stuff like, oh, well, you know, we don't know, but that doesn't necessarily mean God. Well, okay, let's go there. Let's go there. Let's not say God, and let's just say, let's find the attributes of whatever had caused this. We know it had to be more powerful than us. It had to be much more intelligent than you and I. It also had to pre-exist whatever it created, meaning the universe. It also had to be spaceless, timeless, and material. So when you get done with the attributes, you have something that pretty much looks like God.
Well, no, that is the inferential argument. An atheist trying to characterize as therefore God. No, I'm not taking this idea of God over here and just kind of plugging it in over there. No, we have the attributes, and we can read over the attributes and say, this is actually kind of sounding a little familiar here, you know? And so, no, God is not just an explanation that's crammed into it. And they'll say, which, you know, it doesn't tell us it's the God of the Bible. No, it doesn't. It doesn't have to. All it says is, yes, there's a God with these attributes. Now, is the God of the Bible this God? That's another argument. I think there's a strong case to be made for that. But it's what my friend Max calls the animization of evidence, is that they will not accept a cumulative argument. You have to have one argument that gives you the whole picture, otherwise the whole thing has to be discarded, you know?
Yeah, that's
again, is not the logic we use for anything else in our lives. It's like
right.
atheists have this way of thinking that they apply only to atheism, and that no human being thinks in these terms anywhere else in their lives. Like what I was saying about, the Betty Crocker recipe and the Pythagorean theorem. No, you would not say that things are contradictory just because they're not the same. But in retardo atheism world, yeah, that's exactly.
That's how it works. The Twilight Zone. It's scary. Well, we got about two more minutes. So I guess I'll let you hit closing remarks. You're the guest. You can't have closing remarks, man.
No. I'm terrible at this kind of stuff. Well, it was a pleasure speaking with you.
Oh, absolutely. We'll do it. Again, much obliged, man. Much obliged.
Thank you, man.
I guess what I could say ending is certainly science is a great tool. Like I said, we can use it so we can learn how the universe works, but how the universe necessarily got here, why it got here, where are we going, what happens to you when you die, is there a god, who is this god? Science doesn't answer that, but there are other frames of reference, other tools we can use outside of science that I think work very finely if you actually use them along with the scientific information that we have. I would actually ask any atheist who's watching or who will watch to actually try your best to commit yourself not only to just science, but also go into philosophy and art and theology and et cetera, and use these other reference points of knowledge, because there are other ways of gaining information about the natural world besides science alone. And you're actually limiting yourself when you limit yourself to just scientific investigation, when there's also philosophical and theological and mathematical investigation as well. So
yes, there are processes of reasoning, just as the inductive scientific method is a method of inductive reasoning. There are other methods of reasoning. They're not just saying, oh, I'm going to believe something on no evidence at all. No one is advocating that view that you believe something on no evidence at all. You use your reason, but you do not arbitrarily confine yourself to inductive scientific reasoning.
It's funny, the guy who we actually get the problem solving method from that we actually use in science wasn't a scientist. He was a mathematician. His name was George Polya. He had a four-step problem solving method. Basically, it sounds similar to the scientific method. One of the things he had different is you recheck your problem, or you basically try and tear your problem down. And so scientists looked at George Polya's method, and they said, oh, we can take this mathematical model and we can kind of use it in our science. And yeah, so when we do science, a lot of times with physics, we also do math, which is pretty awesome. So yeah. How many atheists would say we need to stop using math and only use science? Well, math and science go hand in hand. So I don't see why you wouldn't use one to help get better knowledge about the other. So it's not that these fields are mutually exclusive to one another, but there's a time and a place to use one, and there's a time and a place not to use the other. But I think we're raising up a generation that are going to have academic restrictions on their knowledge because they think science answers all. When in reality, when you really look at it, science only answers a small percentage.
Yes.
So that's what I would say. And I guess I'm pretty much done. If you have anything else to say, hey, we can go there. And
that's pretty much. I enjoyed talking to you.
Me too. Much obliged. You're a real gentleman. We got about one more minute, which that really doesn't even matter because we're about to go off live anyway. But I'm Wayne Philmore. That's Deflating Atheism. Thank you for the people who have came in and who have tuned in and watched. And leave your comments below. Oh, also share this video with everybody, and whoever channel you're watching this on, whether it's my channel or his, feel free to subscribe. And until next time, good luck and good night.